Our New Testament reading for today comes from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 5 through 11. Is that what you've got? That's what I've got. Okay. It's never dull, that's all I can say. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's laws. Indeed, it cannot, and those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, you are in the Spirit. Since the Spirit of God dwells in you, anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies and through his Spirit that dwells in you. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And let us go to God in prayer. God, open our hearts and our minds this day so that what we do is your word and how we act is your will. And give us the courage to do that now and always. Amen. When I was between the ages of 15 and 21, so what's that, 6 years ago? When I was between the ages of 15 and 21, I was involved in the youth group of my church as a teenager, later as a helper, and so on and so forth. During that time, I was very involved in the youth group. I was trying to be a good boy, trying to make the right choices. I had church friends. I went to youth group. On several occasions, I went to Christian concerts or went to see these dynamic Christian speakers. And I lived in California at the time. It was a very popular thing to do. I heard Mike Warnke explain what life was like as a member of the rock group Black Sabbath, about how debauched his life was, and about how he was eventually saved by Christ. I heard Raul Roos speak about his life as a troubled teenager, a life that involved crime and gang activity, and how his life was turned around and eventually he became a minister of one of the largest churches in California. I had a friend of mine that I worked with at the hotel we worked at together. His teenage years were spent doing drugs and drinking. He too was in a band whose sole purpose was to get drugs and all the girls. When I met him, he had committed his life to God. He worked as a mailman and as a waiter at the hotel. He was the lead guitarist for a Christian rock band, and they would end each concert with testimonials and an altar call. I listened to these and other wonderful stories, and I listened to these fantastic Christian people who had lived a sinful life, a life that Paul would call living according to the flesh. But through the power of God, they devoted their lives to Christ and completely turned everything around, and they lived by Christ's Spirit. And the more I listened to these stories, the more I wanted an answer to these questions. Why were we listening to these people who turned their lives around? As special and as dynamic as their message was, why weren't we listening to people who never had to turn their lives around? Why weren't we listening to people who always had the Spirit of God in them? Wouldn't their story of having the courage to remain in Christ's Spirit and not be tempted away, wouldn't that send the same powerful message? I think that's what I like about this passage of Scripture. Here the people who live in the Spirit are uplifted. They are noticed. They are rewarded. Paul states that there are two kinds of people in this world: those who are of the flesh and those who are of the Spirit. John Stott, in his book Romans, Encountering the Gospel's Power, has this to say. Here are two categories of people: the unregenerate, who are in the flesh, and the regenerate, who are in the Spirit. There are two mindsets here, the mind of the flesh and the mind of the Spirit. which leads to two patterns of conduct of living according to the flesh or to the spirit. The result is two spiritual states, death or life, enmity or peace. Thus our mind, where we set it and how we occupy it, plays a key role in both our present conduct and our final destiny. So today we are going to look at both types of people and discover into which camp we belong. Let's look at those who live according to the flesh. Paul says of this group of people, they have their mind set on what the flesh desires. This person, governed by the flesh, is governed by that which is death. This person's mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's laws, for it cannot do so. This life is controlled by our sinful nature and is centered on our own selfish desires. This life is not God-controlled. It is controlled by something else that fuels the individual. Now, what is this something else? It could be anything. It could be ambition. Instead of God being in control, it is the person's desire to be the best, to reach the pinnacle of their career, to have success be the driving force in their life. Maybe that controlling thing in their life is money, being rich, being powerful due to your wealth, having a passion for making money, having more money than one could ever spend. Maybe the driving force is pride, having to be the best, having to show everyone else up, having to win all the time, doing things for the applause and the accolades. Could it be that someone could be fueled by their selfishness, doing whatever one wants with no regards of consequence, wanting to be popular at all costs, letting your needs and wants rule your heart, needing to be in control at all times and not being able to trust God to be the one in charge of your life? The life controlled by the flesh is about self. It does not seek out God, nor does it live by the laws of God. And the dangerous thing about this life is that the more it is lived, the farther the individual becomes removed from God and God's love. When we think of this type of individual, I'm sure that we automatically think of all the bad and wicked people in the world, people in prison, people who live their lives in reckless ways. But the person who lives by the flesh can be anyone who puts the self ahead of God. Now, the other kind of life, according to Paul, is a person who lives by the Spirit. Again, referring to verse 5, the following we can discover about this person. Those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. Their mind is governed by the Spirit is life and peace. If Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. The life that is controlled by the Spirit is the person who is never separated from God, a person who needs Jesus in their life as much as they need air to breathe. When this person does a good deed, it is to further God's kingdom. When they think, it is about God. When they live, it is for God. A Spirit-filled person is a person who lives for joy. And joy can be defined as putting Jesus first, others second, and yourself last. Barclay says that this person's life is God-focused, Christ-centered, and Spirit-controlled. What a great way to live, a fantastic goal to have, a wonderful way to serve. God is our focus, Christ is our center, and the Spirit is in control. That indeed would be a wonderful life. Paul presents us with two ways to live, one that takes you further from God and one that brings you closer to God. Now, I think I know which life we think we are living, we want to be living, we strive to be living. And according to Paul, we are living. In verse 9, he says, "You are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. These two lives go in opposite directions, and unfortunately, both can be part of our living. There are certainly times when we are living by the flesh. I know I do this all the time. Times when we are selfish, times when we don't trust God, times when we have to be in control instead of God, times when our sinful nature, our wants and desires take center stage. The important thing to remember is that we don't live in that realm. We live in the realm of the Spirit. God's Spirit is absolutely inside of us. If it wasn't, we wouldn't be here. We wouldn't be invested in this church, in each other's lives, in our own faith journeys. Every time we say a prayer, we read from Scripture, we ask for forgiveness, God's Spirit is working within us. Each time we help a person in need, engage in mission, and ask ourselves, what would Jesus do? God's Spirit is working within us. Whenever we repent, whenever we make the right choice, stay on the correct path, remain faithful, God's Spirit is working in us. When we keep on trying, realize that each day is a day to serve God, and when we receive that gift of grace, God's Spirit is working in us, and God's Spirit is filling our lives. We have to be aware of that, and we have to live that way. There once was a successful businessman. He owned and was the CEO and operated a huge corporation. Now, this man was getting to his golden years. I would never say old, just getting to the time where the next stage is to retire. And he has no children, he has no family, he's devoted his whole life to his business. So he needs to find someone to designate as the next CEO, someone who can own and run his company and take it into the future. So he decides to call his 10 executives, his whatever you call them, executives, managing directors. He designates 10 people, one of which he is going to make the next CEO. And he calls them all together in the boardroom and he says, in a very short time, I'm going to retire and I'm going to hand my company over to one of you. And I have to decide which one of you is best suited to lead this company into the future. And here's how I'm going to do it, he says, because I'm going to give each of you a handful of seeds, and you are going to go home and you are going to plant the seeds in a pot, and you are going to grow whatever plant comes out of those seeds, and the one that produces the best job, the best plant, will be the CEO of this company. Okay, so Jim goes home, and he tells his wife the whole story, and they talk about it, and they pray about it. And in case you haven't noticed, Jim's the good Christian, so he's the star of our story. And they talk about it, and they pray about it, and they decide that they're going to do it. So his wife goes out, and she buys the best pot she can, and the best topsoil, and a book on how to grow plants in a pot, and off they go. Harry goes home and tells his wife, and they decide that he's a lock for the CEO, because his wife is a florist, and has a degree in botany, and growing plants as a breeze. So they're already making plans on what to do when he becomes CEO. Joe's ambivalent one way or the other. He goes home, he starts to plan, doesn't know if he can do it, doesn't know if he can't do it, feels he deserves to be the CEO, so off he goes, ready to go. And Jill decides that she's locked into this because she's a woman. The only woman who's considered for the position, but everybody knows women can grow plants, and they can do it better than men. So as time goes by and the executives are in this contest, they talk about it, as you would. They talk about it throughout the time at the office. Harry's plant is growing so strong and healthy, he's had to repot it 4 times. He just can't believe how this is working. Joe's plant is not the tallest that he expected, but it's certainly got very strong roots, and it's as lush as can be. Jill's plant's doing fabulous because she sings to it, and she talks to it. She gives the nurturing side that only a woman could do. And Jim doesn't say anything. He just says, let's wait and see, because his plant isn't doing well at all. So the time comes where tomorrow, when they go home at night, tomorrow they're instructed to come to the boardroom with their plans. And Joe talks to his wife that night and he says, you know what, we've got a tiny, tiny, tiny little bud. This thing isn't growing. It's not going to grow. I don't know what to do. And his wife says, well, this is Jim, right? His wife says, well, Jim, you've got three choices as I see it. You can be honest and say you did your best and nothing happened. We can go out tonight and buy a plant and switch it and hope that all works out. He's thinking about this, you know, mulling it over as she is saying it, trying to figure out what the best approach would be. And I'm sitting here mulling over, I forgot what the third thing is. I'm sitting here trying to remember what it is, trying not to show you that I've blown it, and I can't remember what the third thing is. So the third thing is he, no, it went away again. What is that? I can't remember. I guess I didn't memorize this one as much as I thought I would. So I'll just keep going and it'll pop back into my head. So they get to the boardroom, and there are 10 executives, 9 of which are standing with beautiful plants, and there's Joe with his empty pot. And so the CEO makes wonderful comments on all the plants and how beautiful they are and what a wonderful job they did. And when he gets to the man with the empty pot, because I keep using the wrong name, when he gets to the man with the empty pot, he says, what's going on? What, you can't, you thumbing your nose at this contest, you can't grow, why would you come here with an empty pot? And so he says, you know, I simply tried my best. We got the best topsoil, we got books, we got the best pot. I did my best and it didn't work. I thought about coming in here with a new plant to pass it off. I thought about saying that I decided it wasn't worth it and I was withdrawing from the contest. That was the bit I missed. He said, but my wife and I talked about it, my wife and I prayed about it, and we decided the best approach to this was for me to be honest. And this was the best I could do, and this is what my best produced. And so the CEO said, thank you. He went into his office. He came out a while later, having made his decision. And of course, as these stories go, the man with the empty pot becomes the next CEO of this huge corporation. And everyone is incensed. And they can't believe it. They've got these wonderful plants. They said, you said the one with the biggest, best plant would be the next CEO. You went back on your word. And the man said, I told you the one that produced the best would be the next CEO. And I gave you all a handful of boiled seeds. Nothing should have grown in your pots, because there's more to being a CEO and a leader than simply being the best. It takes honesty, and it takes integrity, and it takes someone who lives from their heart. And that is the man with the empty pot. Paul says that we live two ways. We either live by the flesh, or we live by the spirit. When we live by the flesh, it is selfish, it is of our own heart, it is our own desires that we seek, and we move further and further from God. But when we live by the Spirit, we live with the Spirit of God inside of us. We do to help other people. We think and ask ourselves what Jesus would do. We move closer and closer to God each day, because when we live with Jesus' Spirit right here. And that is a wonderful goal to have. Now and always, let us pray. Gracious God, be with us this and each day. Help us to live by the Spirit. Help us to do what we need to do now and always.